More Americans voted in the 2020 election than ever before.
But the aftermath magnified how deeply divided our country is.
Our democracy is being severely tested.
Stormed the Capitol building. They are marching through now.
We are seeing the very real and deadly consequences of misinformation.
And distrust in our institutions.
We are learning that we can't take our democracy for granted.
Despite the violence, our government continues to do its work.
And now we want to see our country heal.
I voted because people I care about are in danger.
I voted because I want to make a better future for the next generation and my children.
As we continue to confront the pandemic, racial injustice, and economic crisis, we must remember what is important to us.
We, the people.
We, the young people
of the United States
want a better future. Together.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to We the Young People. I'm your host, Amna Nawaz, senior correspondent for the PBS NewsHour. Now, the inauguration of Joe Biden as the next president of the United States marks the start of a new four-year term, and the peaceful transfer of power from one president to the next is an American democratic tradition that's been upheld since the 1700s. But this has been a transition like none other. As Congress met to certify the election results, a pro-Trump rally turned into an assault on the U.S. Capitol building. That's something that hasn't happened in modern American history. Multiple crises and this contentious election have taken a toll on America's image in the world, not to mention our faith and our trust in democratic institutions. Now, many of you voted for the first time in 2020, so today we're going to talk about the things that are important to you and how young people are working to build a stronger democracy. You're going to hear from my good friend and colleague, Yamiche Alcindor, our White House correspondent. You'll also hear from young elected officials about why they entered public service. We'll learn more about the consequences of misinformation and talk with youth activists about what they expect from the next administration. We also want to hear from you. So start a conversation in the chat and drop in your questions. We will get to them at the end of the show. This program was created by the team at Student Reporting Labs. That's a youth media program from the NewsHour that empowers students across the country to produce unique youth-focused journalism. All right, let's get it started. Now, Yamiche recently hosted a conversation about the historic nature of America's first female vice president with three of our Gwen Ifill fellows. This fellowship was created to honor the legacy of Gwen Ifill, a trailblazing journalist who co-anchored the NewsHour before her death in 2016.
Good to talk to all of you. Tell me where you're joining us from and what you are all up to.
I'm a recent graduate from the University of North Texas, where I studied broadcast journalism. And Yamiche, I've always looked up to you so much, so this is really such a privilege to be able to talk to you.
I'm Jayla. I'm in Bowie, Maryland. I'm currently a production assistant with Student Reporting Labs.
I'm Angeline. I'm from Houston, Texas, and I'm a student at the University of Houston studying media production.
Mercedes, you talked about being excited to talk to me. We all, of course, have women that we look up to. Talk to me a little bit about representation and role models. Vice President-elect Harris said in her post-election address,
"But while I may be the first woman in this office, I will not be the last."
What does it mean to all of you to have a woman be elected for the first time Vice President of the United States?
It's just crazy how it's taken this long to get here. And it's almost as if she's kind of representing the rest of us that live here to say, hey, we live here too. We can have authority.
It just felt like another barrier that was put in place to hold us back got knocked down.
I think about the younger generations. So for them to see something like that, that's just so positive, and just be like, oh, I look like her too, or oh, my mom looks like her, and feel like they can also just accomplish things and good things are happening in the world, I really find that just really beautiful.
How does your background resonate with all of you, especially given the fact that we are, of course, all women of color sitting here right now?
As a person of color, like, I've grown up with Black siblings, Black aunts, Black uncles, a Black mom, Black dad, and I think Kamala, with that perspective, can speak to a lot of the issues that people like me face in America.
I've seen a lot of comments where people say, oh, she's not actually Black, she's not actually Indian. I've always been super conflicted. Like, I know I'm American, but what's the definition of being a true American? Or am I even really Filipino because I live here? And that's always been an internal struggle for me.
You don't have to be one type of Black in a way. Like, you can be made up of several ethnicities and still be Black. And I was glad to see how Kamala really handled it. She was just like, this is who I am, this is my identity. If you don't like it, oh well, I'm Black. You can try to tell me I'm not, but I know I am. And I really appreciated that.
When you think of your life, who are you looking up to? Who have you looked up to in the past?
Growing up, I honestly never really had women of color that I could look up to, I guess just besides my mom.
Of course, my mother and the women around me. Of course, Gwen Ifill, she was one person I really looked up to because I would just watch her and just be like, I could do that. And that's honestly how I got into journalism in the first place.
I have to say, the theme of this conversation seems to be moms. My biggest inspiration is definitely my mother. She immigrated here from Haiti in the 1970s, went on to get a PhD. Seeing her do her job as a single mom raising my brother and me in Miami, it was just inspiring to see her. She was someone who I felt like just powered through life. And when I still hit roadblocks, I think, well, my mom did this. What do you think your generation is facing that maybe other women didn't, or maybe you're facing some of the same things that other women in past generations faced?
For me, I've just had a few instances where I would be doing something in this field, like a film project or something like that, and just a few people have told me, oh, it's great to see people or women like you doing stuff like this, and it was never a bad thing. I guess I just never really realized why that was important or what, like, the big deal was.
I actually have this conversation a lot with my mom. She always tells me, she's like, your generation is just so different from mine, because she immigrated here in, I believe, the early 80s from Nigeria. So she's like, certain things that you just feel free to say and do, I didn't.
I sometimes have to tell you, I'm amazed at the fact that I'm a White House correspondent, that I'm sitting next to Judy Woodruff, someone that has covered so many presidents, sitting on set. Sometimes I get starstruck, even though Judy's my boss, even though Judy's someone that I talk to all the time. I text with her, I go drink tea at her house. I still think to myself, oh my God, I get to work with Judy Woodruff. Oh my God, I'm a national correspondent. I get to be on TV. Sometimes when the lights come on, I'm like, oh my God, it's a million people watching. What am I gonna do? That to me is how you stay humble. It's how you stay good at your job, because you recognize the privilege that you occupy. Talk to me a little bit about this administration. What beyond representation do you hope Vice President Harris and this administration will accomplish?
I just hope that this new administration will bring back the climate conversation.
As someone who literally just graduated into a pandemic in December 2019, I would love to see what this administration would do for the student loan crisis in America, because so many Americans are not financially free, and that just is like shackles on them.
I also just hope that they keep the promises that they promised to the Black community and the community of color.
I get a lot of times people asking me, what advice would you give to young women who want to get into the media? What advice would you give to them? The biggest advice I could give you is to just do the work and to find people who believe in you. For the people who don't believe in you, leave them aside. Go find mentors, go find editors, go find producers who see what you see in yourself, who are confident in the fact that you can continue to grow. Yes, you're gonna make mistakes. I've made mistakes. I've had to get corrections in the New York Times. I've had to do over stand-ups 20 times because I couldn't get the teleprompter right. You will make mistakes just like everyone makes mistakes. But know that if you press forward, if you keep your eye on the prize, you can get that. And I will tell you, I'm someone who was told, maybe you're not pretty enough to be on TV. Maybe you're not skinny enough to be on TV. Maybe you should straighten your hair. I didn't take any of that. Luckily, my mother was there to say, you are beautiful. You're gonna go exactly the way you are. Make sure that you have a fundamental core and remember who you are. So thank you so much, ladies, for talking. Thank you so much for sharing the space with me. I'm so excited to see all of you succeed, that we can call you part of the PBS family. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Dear Mr. President and Madam Vice President, education is so fundamental to the success of the individuals, the community, and the country as a whole. But unfortunately, not all kids are getting the academic opportunities and resources that they need to be successful. I've seen too many of my peers falling behind because of their socioeconomic backgrounds or even their mental health, and it's not fair. And I think it's just because of the way that the education system is structured. I hope this is as important of an issue to you as it is to me.
As a result of the events that have happened, how do you think America will be different going forward?
I would like to hope that the scenes of angry Americans storming one of our nation's sacred buildings is enough to inspire changes.
What do you hope that students can take away from seeing this experience happen in our own country?
Don't take democracy for granted. And honestly, I think about my life. I think I've taken democracy for granted. I've come to expect that there are certain lines that you wouldn't cross.
I agree with that. It's also just really crazy. You would always, like, other countries, it would be that, you know, America, like, wow, like, that's what we want to be like, or that's what we look up to. But if we were looking in on what's happening right now to us, we would want to go in and help.
We're facing police brutality and systemic racism in this country. Just in the past year, there's been several protests, several riots happen, and that really affects my day-to-day life. As a Black person, I'm wondering if I'm gonna be okay at the end of the day, every day I go out, if I'm gonna be all right, if something's gonna happen to me. And I would really like to ask you guys what you can do in your power to change that.
What drives individuals to public service in this era of polarized politics and diminishing faith in institutions? Sophia Varani of Oakland Technical High School in California interviewed three young elected officials who won their first elections in November.
19-year-old Tony LaBranche is an incoming member of the New Hampshire State House of Representatives. His interest in public service began in the hospital when he was 10.
I was diagnosed with stage 3 colon cancer. The hospital bills in the $400,000 range. My family went into debt and we struggled for a while. Seeing how unjust and exploitive the American healthcare system is has driven me to be a public servant and why I wanted to run for office.
LaBranche's first step into political life was when he ran for school board to help fix local schools.
We have leaky ceilings. Most classrooms do not have heating in the winter. I lost by about 245 votes.
LaBranche had better luck in November 2020 when he was elected as one of three Democrats in Amherst to win a seat in the state legislature.
Do you think there's pressure being a young person in politics? Because I feel like there's always been that kind of like message of like, oh, the next generation is gonna fix all of America's problems.
I think that more people of my generation should be running for office. We actually need to be participating in the political process if we really do want to solve the issues. Our public university system in New Hampshire is unaffordable. So that is one of my priorities. And another priority is to reduce the inequality in public schools.
Is it weird for people to call you Representative Tony LaBranche?
It still is a shock to me that I was even elected. I personally prefer being called Tony, but it's an honor to be a representative.
28-year-old Republican Kristen O'Shea is the youngest woman ever elected to the Kansas State Senate.
How do you think your parents' church and volunteering work inspired you to run for office?
I think it was a way of life. On the weekends, bring branches to the powwow site, and with mom, we would go to quilters with the little ladies and tie quilts for Lutheran World Relief, but also helping make sure, you know, the treasury budgets were working.
Why did the COVID-19 pandemic make you want to run for office?
The shutdowns really drastically affected small business negatively.
The inconsistencies between a big business and a small business weren't great. Every time I would see the pictures of an elderly person behind a screen talking to their loved ones because they couldn't go into a nursing home, my heart would just break. I stayed out of politics, but I think if good people aren't running for office, making those decisions that affect everyone's lives, then who is?
Do you have a message for young women looking to go into public service?
Women tend to think we have to know everything before we can take the step to do it.
All the little steps throughout my life of being involved and being in leadership all leads up to public service.
You're ready for it even when you don't think you are.
26-year-old Democrat Abraham Ayosh won a seat in the Michigan House of Representatives.
I'm in this position, unfortunately, because my state representative and political mentor, Isaac Robinson, passed away in late March from suspected COVID. First time I met him, when I was just 13, working on the Barack Obama campaign, he says, you know, I'm your Jewish, Irish, Catholic brother from the hood. I was re-inspired by the 2016 election and saw a call to service, especially after my uncle was killed by an airstrike in Yemen, just days before the initial travel ban was signed. That sort of reminded me that it wasn't enough to simply have the right values, but there was a need to step in and fight and engage in that process. As a child of immigrants, as a Muslim, as someone who grew up in an intersectional community that was largely Black and brown and working class and poor, that I bring that lens into the legislature. They say Isaac had big shoes to fill. Quite literally, he's a size 14. But I'm about a size 11, so I hope I can come close to continuing the fight.
Hey, Ashanti, how are you doing?
Hi, I'm doing good. How are you, Mr. Smith?
Ashanti, now that you're, you know, an official voter and part of the democratic process, how do you foresee the events that have taken place over the past year will affect our future as a democratic society?
I mean, I'm really used to all of the negativity. I was born a year after 9/11. And it seemed like since then, everything's been going downhill with the viruses and the wars and all of the conflicts. So hopefully in the future, it will be less conflict and more hope. Do you think our democracy is pretty strong?
At the moment, not at all. Many of us were caught up in the reality TV of it all or the counterculture of it all, forgetting that there are democratic norms such as bowing out when you lose an election and allowing the next person to succeed. Obviously, you are part of our future leaders, and the fact that you are so involved and engaged gives me hope that democracy will be restored in the future. And I can't wait to see what you and your peers do to better our country.
Misinformation and disinformation continue to have a massive impact here in America. We partnered with MediaWise, a media literacy program from Poynter, to learn what you can do to stop it. And full disclosure, I am an ambassador with the program. Now, Bridget Aduwadie, a Student Reporting Labs fellow and former teen fact-checker with MediaWise, talked with a misinformation expert to help us understand the scope of the problem. You're then going to hear from Heaven Taylor Wynn, a multimedia reporter for MediaWise, who spoke with two other MediaWise teen fact-checkers about how they managed to keep their own social media experience healthy.
I have with me Dr. Jevin West, who teaches at the University of Washington, and he's been doing a lot of research about misinformation and disinformation.
Thanks for having me, Bridget.
As a teen fact checker, I sometimes get really worried about what might happen if we don't address this problem of misinformation.
It's difficult to solve a pandemic. It's difficult to solve problems of planetary health and economic health and societal health if we can't get the information right.
What keeps you up at night?
That the younger generation just starts to lose trust in everything. If you look at the many studies and surveys that are done every single year around trust of different institutions like journalism, government, military, it's going down across the board. Our democracy depends on some level of trust in those institutions and each other. And if they don't trust anything, that's what scares me the most. It's also the goal of a lot of those organizations and bad actors that are pushing disinformation campaigns.
How can we get through to people who have completely lost faith or have really low trust in institutions and in facts and science?
Bring more empathy into these conversations to understand when someone is concerned, let's say it is about vaccinations, and to talk to them like a human and to talk to them and ask them questions about where they get their information and talk to them about the difficulty of getting to truth, but that you can get to truth. You know, there's some people that think the world could be destroyed by things like nuclear weapons. Of course it could, and other things, but it also could be destroyed even by social media too. So we got to take that serious as well.
Oh, well, thank you so much, Jevin.
Thank you, Bridget.
Hi, everyone. I'm Heaven Taylor Wynn, and I'm a multimedia reporter for MediaWise. And I'm so happy to be joined today by two of our team fact checkers, Lauren and Angie. They've contributed countless hours to helping us debunk more than 400 claims in the past 2 years. Lauren and Angie, welcome. Just to kick things off, I want to hear about your experiences as a teen fact checker.
First, I was thinking of misinformation as like those really big like propaganda type posters, but it turns out that there's misinformation everywhere. It's in your Facebook feed, in your Instagram stories. And the thing about misinformation is that it isn't intentional. Usually people have good intentions of sharing information to help inform other people, but sometimes things don't quite go the way that they expected.
I think you hit it right on the head in that a lot of times the misinformation is unintentional, but at the same time, you know, disinformation is absolutely intentional. What about you, Lauren?
I think a lot of people my age definitely see it as a little weird that I'm a fact checker when I'm so young. It's not a typical, you know, hobby that teenagers have. But I think it's really important when you're sharing information on your personal social media, because even if you don't have a million followers, even if you just have a few hundred, you're an influencer. And I think it's important that every teen is a fact checker.
All right, so we saw the consequences of misinformation in real life when a group of protesters who believed in the baseless claims that President Trump had won the election stormed the U.S. Capitol. What advice would you have for people who may be victims of this kind of misinformation?
So I think the big thing is to realize that it's not your fault. With the way that social media is set up, where it rewards things that are really highly emotional, or really highly argumentative, or the echo chambers that also come along with that, and the fact that misinformation usually isn't spread on purpose.
People can turn to violence and hurting others just because they saw something that wasn't true, that was so easily preventable. And I think that if we don't fix this soon, then things like this are going to keep happening.
Even over the past election season, with the way that the misinformation has been spreading about like political candidates or election results or even the voting, the mail-in ballots, the very underpinnings of our democracy and our society may start coming apart unless we fix the issue of misinformation.
Well, thank you both so much for sitting down and talking with me. I really enjoyed it, and we don't get to have these conversations so often. So thank you so much.
Dear Mr. President and Madam Vice President,
my hope for my community and this country is that we stand more united than when you began your presidency.
My hope for my country and my community is that everyone will be able to receive free health care despite their financial situation.
I hope that you will seriously research the implications of fake news on social media.
I hope to see a progressive plan in combating climate change.
I think it would be nice of you to help low-income families with COVID protection. Doing things like opening up little health centers in low-income areas so people can get the help they need.
Continue to bring money back to middle-class families, continue to rise the poor out of unemployment and back into jobs in our country.
Do you plan on addressing this volatile split in America right now? And if so, how? Do you think you can repair this break?
I put my faith in you to end systemic racism and tear down all the barriers that come with it.
Got some big hopes and some big dreams for the years ahead. Hi, everyone. I'm Amna. I'm back with you. And I want to send a big, big thank you to all of the students who contributed their voices to this special. It reminds us there's a lot of work to be done, but there's still a lot of reasons to be hopeful as well. Finally, tonight, I want you to hear from some very special guests. We've got some young activists with us who are on the front lines of civic engagement. Each of them is working in their own way on the issues that matter most to them. And I'm so excited to introduce them to you now. First up is Andrea Gonzalez from New York. She is 20 years old. She's an advocate for gun violence prevention with the organization Youth Over Guns. She's also working towards a social justice and child advocacy degree at the City University of New York. Andrea, welcome to you.
Thank you so much for having me.
Also with us is Benji Backer in Seattle. He's 23 years old. He's the founder and president of the American Conservation Coalition. Benji recently graduated from the University of Washington. He now serves on the Leadership Council for the Wisconsin Conservative Energy Forum. Benji, thanks for being here.
An absolute pleasure. Thanks so much.
And also with us is Aaliyah Logan. Aaliyah is 18. She's from the Bronx. Her advocacy focuses on community safety, on education equity, and gender equality. She's currently a UNICEF youth advocate and a freshman at Smith College. Aaliyah, welcome to you. Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much for having me today.
All right, guys, I'm so happy and so excited to be speaking with all of you tonight. I just want to jump right in and learn more about why you do what you do. Andrea, let's start with you, because I came across a quote in a book. It was by Zero Hour's Jamie Margolin called Youth to Power. And here's what you said. You said, "I'm not an activist by choice. I'm an activist for survival." What did you mean by that? Tell me about that.
Absolutely. So I think it's really important to understand that activism should not be a hobby. Activism is oftentimes the only way that we honor the lives that we've lost, the way that we honor our stories, our narratives, and the experiences we've had with state violence. And so in an ideal world, we wouldn't have to advocate for our lives. We wouldn't have to scream to the crowd that our lives matter. So this is because of survival that I have to do this work. The reason why my community has to advocate for themselves is for survival purposes. We see the way that the state harms us, and we just know that it's very important to continue doing this work.
Aaliyah, what about you? Change, as we all know, it's a process, right? It happens in a lot of different ways. So how do you make that change?
Such a great question. I think when I started this work, I didn't really know how to make change. I think going into it, I was kind of confused and like didn't know the right route to take. But I think after being in this work, I think you look at the wisdom of our elders and young people's energies, and you can see that tangible change can be made. So whether we're looking at the Black Lives Matter movement or climate change or the Women's March, you see young people at the forefront listening to their elders decades before. And I think change for me is organizing on the grounds and really educating other young people. And I think there is a common notion that we have to give a voice to the voiceless, when in reality, everyone has a voice, everyone has a story. So my work is really ensuring that every space is safe for a diverse group of people to enter in and be able to share their stories.
At the same time, though, Aaliyah, I hear what you're saying, and I want Benji to pick up where you left off, because organizing and trying to get people out into the streets or going to the halls of power, you can't exactly do that during a pandemic, right? You've had to change and shift some of your tactics. So tell me a little bit about that. How do you continue to practice and see forward your advocacy safely during a pandemic?
Well, look, I think, first of all, the fact that so many young people turned out for the 2020 election is proof that we were still advocating and making action during the pandemic. I actually think that one of the best things about the pandemic is the awareness that we have now as young people that we can take that activism from being in the streets and turn that into action as well. Vote, write your legislator, you know, contact them via email or phone or on social media. Put the pressure on, because just because there's a pandemic doesn't mean that these issues go away or that they slow down. This is an opportunity for us to ramp it up. And even if we can't be in person, we can still make a huge difference. We've continued to do that throughout the pandemic, and I know that our age group is going to continue to do so regardless of how the next few months shake out.
So we've got audience questions coming in too. I'm going to try to work these into the conversation as we go. And Aaliyah, I'm going to come back to you to follow up on something you mentioned earlier. Madeline McGee is asking about how adults can support and encourage the civic and political participation of young people. You mentioned learning from the wisdom of your elders and taking the energy of the young. So how can adults support what you're doing?
For starters, thank you so much, Madeline, for that question. I think I often get asked that, how can adults support young people? And I think for starters, is ensuring that young people are in spaces where policy decisions are being made. Oftentimes, I find myself, you know, questioning how qualified I am to be in spaces or how important my voice is. So it's very important for adults and adult allies to really ensure and remind young people that there are the most impacted by issues, and they should be the people who are, you know, in the rooms of decision making policies and making sure that our voices are heard. So really ensuring that adults are actually listening to us and ensuring that we are being heard in all spaces.
I find that so interesting. Do you still question the validity of your voice, even as passionate and as experienced as you are doing this? You still sometimes think, am I doing and saying the right thing?
Yeah, all the time, even right now. All the time I think that. And I think it just comes with this work, you know? And I think I would say that everyone on this panel feels that way often, but it's really ensuring that I remind myself that if someone, it's usually I'm the only person that looks like or has the same identities that I do hold in the room. So it is important for me to be there and to be representing the communities and that, the identities that I am from.
Benji and Andrea, I'm curious, do either of you want to weigh in on this? This idea of like sticking with your voice, knowing what you're doing is the right thing to do, the right path to follow. Do you ever feel that self-doubt too? And how do you work through it? Benji, let's start with you.
Yeah, well, look, I mean, you're going to have that feeling all the time as a young activist. And the most important thing that you can do is continue to press on because you have a different perspective than anybody else in the world. And you for sure have a different perspective than anybody in any other generation. Our generation as Gen Z or young millennials, we have a different outlook and a different, you know, perspective on issues that we want to push forward. And so your voice is part of that perspective and it needs to be heard because we live in a era, like any era, where older people are dominating the conversation. And so young people leveraging their voice allows us to push the envelope on issues that we care about. And going back quickly to the question that you asked earlier about how adults can listen, adults need to be open to change. We're in a new generation, we're in a new era now, and older folks need to realize that there are differences in opinion from young people as there are to older people. And as a conservative, seeing how young conservatives and young liberals align on a lot of the issues is a change that older generations need to be more open to.
Andrea, I'm going to let you weigh in on both of those, and then I want to move on to the new administration, but talk to us about those. How can adults support what you're doing, and how do you stay true to your voice?
Absolutely. I think that a lot of young people, they are just so, they're nervous about what they have to share. They're nervous about their experiences, because a lot of times, especially for young people that carry marginalized identities, they are often shut out of conversations. And so it's really, really, really important for adults to uplift them and affirm them in their experiences and make sure that they are passing along opportunities, lets them share their experiences and share what they need to be heard. And so, yeah, I think something that's really important for adults to do. And I just really want that young people to know that their voices are incredibly important and that they are the experts of their own reality and they need to be in those rooms to share their experiences in their community.
So Benji, you mentioned, of course, your perspective as a conservative. And I want to ask you, because we're at this moment in time where people make a lot of assumptions about people on both sides of the political aisle, but especially in this week when we're talking, especially after the events and the insurrection and the Capitol attack last week, those who self-identify with the Republican Party are being asked a lot of tough questions right now. So I want to ask you, what role do you see for young conservatives for the next 4 years?
Well, look, there is an obvious reboot that needs to happen within the conservative movement, and there are important issues that needed to be solved with conservatives being at the table. One of those is the issue that I care about most with the American Conservation Coalition, and that's the environment. All Americans care about the environment, and conservatives need to be a part of those conversations so that we can get things done. But as it pertains to the broader conservative movement, the time for a new Republican Party, a new conservative movement is right now. I joined this movement back in 2008 when I was actually 10 years old. And the amount of change within the conservative movement over that time frame has been really disappointing. Largely, that's because conservatives have been looked at differently in a lot of ways than they probably should be. But those assumptions have come true in a lot of ways over the past couple of years, and it's really important for the conservative movement to return back to a movement of markets and limited government like it used to be, but also a movement that stands up for all people, regardless of their background or political affiliation or, you know, racial ethnicity. There's such an important wave of conservatism that needs to happen over the next 4 years, and our generation can be the ones that make that happen.
Aliyah, I'm curious, because today, conversations around politics or any political issues can get so heated so quickly. So people are sometimes hesitant to share their beliefs and say what it is that they really stand for because they don't want to be labeled or judged. Do you ever feel judged by other young people, your age, you know, people, things when you do express your political beliefs? Do you feel like they're judging you?
Such a great question. And I think I often think about that all the time. And I think this panel, for example, is living proof that you can have people on different sides of the spectrum and have a civilized and respectful conversation. But I think a lot of times I misjudge on what I believe in, just from the appearance of how I look. Many people think I'm in support of one party or in support of one policy. But I think a lot of my activism and my work is really ensuring that we're defending human rights. So oftentimes, I think about policies or even our country as a whole in relation to the international community, seeing how we can support human rights, you know, and ensure that young people all across the world have access to education and girls specifically have access to that. So I do feel judged often, but it's very important for me to push past that and ensure that my policies and my ideas when it comes to human rights are actually being pushed.
Andrea, do you ever have to sort of check your own assumptions when you're talking to someone who identifies with a different set of political beliefs and you want to have a productive conversation? How do you do that? And how do you encourage other people to do the same?
Definitely. So I think it's just extremely important to have empathy when you're coming to these conversations and also to take a deep breath as well, especially for Black and Brown young people who are often called to the table first to talk about issues that directly impact them. And that brings up a lot of trauma for us as well. In the way that I check myself in those conversations, I try to take a deep breath and try to, I don't know, understand that this is just a conversation and that my work isn't going to stop, regardless of the way that the conversation's. And my job as like an educator and as an organizer is to try to get everyone on the same page and champion folks to the cause and uplifting Black and Brown people in this country and across the world. And as long as I'm doing that, I'm going to keep on doing what I'm doing.
So very briefly, I want to hear from each of you before we go, because this is such an important thing for everyone out there watching. And Andrea, I'll start with you. But obviously, the work that you guys do is so important. The change isn't going to happen overnight, right? It's going to take a lot of dedicated effort, and you're going to have to keep working as hard as you have been. So what advice do you have for anyone out there who wants to get involved, who wants to be on the front lines with you, but may feel discouraged in this moment? Andrea, what would you say to them?
To those young people, I would definitely say, look to your community. There are people on the ground in your community doing amazing work. They're the ones that are filling your community fridges. They're the ones who are organizing the marches. Look for those folks. They will guide you and mentor you to where you need to be. And to not be afraid to share what you believe in. I think young people are incredibly imaginative. And so you are essential in these spaces, and activism doesn't look one way. It looks like a million different ways, and that's why it's so beautiful. And so it's just really important for everyone to get involved these conversations in whatever capacity they can.
Benji, what about you? What's your advice?
My advice would be nothing is unsolvable. All the challenges that we face as a society will be solved with the hard work of activists and people who are taking that active mindset into action as well. And on an issue like climate change, which so many of us care about, there isn't going to be one quick solution, but be proud of the progress of taking steps in the right direction over the course of a short amount of time and a long period of time, because we will solve these problems with your leadership. We won't be able to solve them without it. And that's where we really need you to step up and be a part of that change and understand that you're going to be a part of something so much bigger than yourself, but it's going to happen over time in such a strong way because of your leadership. And we want more young people in the movement, and the time is now, and the time is never going to be better than right now.
Aaliyah, last word goes to you.
Just echoing everything Andrea and Benji said, I mean, they hit it right on the nail. It's so important for young people of all ages, of all backgrounds to be included and to feel like their voices are important. You know, I always say that you have to hone on your leadership skills and the skills that you already know, because the fact of the matter is your voice is important, your background is important, everything you're advocating for is extremely important. So really building confidence and building self-harmony is extremely important when getting into this movement and recognizing that we are the young people that are going to make the change.
Well, you guys are just incredible. Seriously, this is such an inspiring conversation. I am in awe of you and everything that you do. I just want to bottle all this up and take a sip from it every day. Thank you, Benji, Aaliyah, and Andrea, for being here, for the work that you do. I am so grateful, and I'm so, so happy I got to talk to you tonight. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
I also want to thank everybody out there who participated in the last 30 minutes of our conversation and everyone out there who joined us in the audience and jumped in the conversation. We're so grateful you could be here with us tonight. And of course, a big, big thank you to Student Reporting Labs and to World Channel for providing support for this inauguration special. Thank you again to everybody for joining us. Again, I'm Amna Nawaz from the PBS NewsHour, and this is where I leave you. Good night, stay safe.